Here today to talk about compression, loudness. Now, I'm going to have a quick show of hands. Let's change that a little bit. Just as a straw poll, how many of you guys think that compression in music is a good thing? Anyone? A couple of guys in there. Good answer. I think one of the great problems that we have in our business is that engineers are fantastic guys. They're very bright. They know their stuff. They're terrible at my job. Just in case anyone doesn't know, my name's Alan Sircom. I'm the editor-in-chief in Hi-Fi Plus in the UK, and I do an awful lot of writing. As I said, engineers are terrible at naming things. So what we have is different types of compression, a number of different types of compression from that we all bundle into one, sometimes one big bad. So for example, we have music compression. Now this is something we don't often talk about. So we have, for example, a piece of music might be played where it's a deliberate musical effect to try and keep the sound compressed, keep the sound shut down. Now, a perfect example of that is possibly a Fender Telecaster guitar. Now, in the hands of Pete Townsend of The Who, that thing is loud and raucous. In the hands of Brad Paisley, it's a completely different thing. One of the differences is Brad Paisley uses a compressor pedal, and that squeezes down the dynamics of the guitar as a deliberate design to make it sound more useful for that kind of chicken-picking rhythm. However, there's also another kind of compression that we talk about, which is data compression. In fact, what we should be talking about is data reduction, because what we take with a piece of music when we compress it, we don't compress it, we chop bits of data off it to try and make it better. But there is another one, and this is a bit of a blight in our business, which is signal compression. Now, over the years, systematically, signal compression, we've come along, we've gone from an era where compressed music, where music didn't really have compression because there wasn't really the instruments to do the compression. We had a very basic, rudimentary system. Over the years, systematically, while we've dealt with people from starting with radio in the 1980s, we have heard more and more compression put on music. Now, what I'm going to play for you today is a series of pieces of music from the 50s through to the present day, about 2004. And I'm going to play, first of all, I'm going to play you a couple of pieces of music that I've said, talked about music compression. I'm going to play that first off. But before that, after that, I'm going to play you a few pieces of music. Now, what I'd like you to do there, none of them are audiophile pressings, none of them are special recordings, and they're all stuff that has been in the charts. They're all things that have been popular at the time. And what I would like you to do is listen. I'm not going to change the volume level at all. We'll come up with a comfy volume level for this, and we'll go from the same pieces of music from the 50s, well, a piece of music from the 50s, as I said, right through to the present day. And I'd like you to listen to the average loudness of this. But first of all, as I was saying, with music compression, I'm going to go back and play two pieces of music. And what I'm going to play first of all is, what I'd like you to listen to is, I'm going to play two pieces of music, and it's the same instrument, near enough, a trumpet or a cornet. The first thing I'm going to play is 85 years old. And it's just, I won't play all of it. I'd love to play all of it, but sadly, I have to chop this, even though it's going to feel like an abomination to me, because it's one of my favorite pieces of music of all time. But what I'm going to do is play this piece of music. First of all, I'd like you to listen to the opening, to the trumpet, for the first few seconds, for its fanfare, and listen for it in its way.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone care to guess who and what that was?
Louis Armstrong.
Yeah. And a track? Okay, so it was West End Blues, which is a wonderful piece of music. Now, Louis Armstrong at that time is playing very, very dynamically. He's making a proper fanfare. Trumpeters love to play fanfares, and it's a beautiful one. What I'm going to play for you now, we're going to jump forward quite a bit of time. And I'm going to play a piece of Miles Davis. And again, listen to the sound of the instrument from there. Now that was from Sketches of Spain, a lovely recording. Again, I haven't picked a particular audiophile recording. Now if you listen to the difference in the two trumpet sounds, one it has a mute, which is a form of compression. Now, it's a musical compression, there's absolutely nothing wrong with using it. It's part of the musician or the recording artist or whatever's decision to make to kind of keep the music kind of quiet. What we're gonna go back to do now is, as I said, I'm going to play up some pieces of music from, as I said, from the 50s to right through the pretty much the present day. I'm going to keep the volume level about the same. What I'd like you to do is listen to the, not necessarily listen to the peaks, but listen to the average volume. See if it gets louder relative to each one. Start, as I said, in the 1950s. Unfortunately, I now can't turn the volume down because we've got the same volume throughout. Now, you lodge that in your memory. You've got that kind of volume level there. So that was a mono recording from the mid to late 50s, early rock and roll. We're going to jump forward a few years. I'd like you to listen to see if the volume level changes, if it goes up or down significantly. Thank you. Now we've moved into stereo era, late 60s. Has it got any louder? Much louder? No. Okay. Now, if you like, we can play the same things from the 70s. We can play some really sort of silly rock like Black Sabbath. But I'm actually going to jump forward a little bit of time. Because at this point, realistically, we didn't have a great deal of compression coming into music. In the 80s, we started to get radio companies, starting in New York and Chicago, who realized that if you're trying to squeeze a piece of music that's got a dynamic range of that much into a car radio, which has a dynamic range of that much, you have to use compression to squeeze that music down. But there's nothing wrong with that for prime time listening. You're going to sit in a car, if you have the full dynamic range of a piece of music, it will sound awful. So they have to, unfortunately, squeeze the music down. Now what they've worked out is that in squeezing the music down, things obviously get quieter because you're listening to the average noise, average level. If you then move the average music level up to the loudest possible thing you can do on radio, you can still hear, you still hear the sound as an average. It doesn't peak, it doesn't go over the top with the radio station, but it gets louder. Now, a perfect example of this is TV commercials. When you listen to a piece of, you watch a TV program, it's fine, you go to the commercials, and they shout! And part of the reason that they do that is it's actually just taking the average levels and pushing them up as far as they can. But the difficulty is, when you get to that, you get to a point where you actually think, well, wait a minute, if I squeeze it down a little more, I can make it a little louder. Squeeze it down a more. And the advantage to that from a commercial perspective is the louder, the more it sells. The disadvantage is, it kind of kills the music. Now, we're going to jump forward to about 1990. Do you want me to replay that last bit to get an idea of those levels, or have you got that lodged in your head? Lodged in your head? Great. I'm going to play something from the 1990s.
Reach out of space.
How did that sound? Louder? Quite a bit louder. I apologize if you're watching this out in internet land, you probably won't be able to hear some of those peaks because we're going to flatten the sounds down. But what we've got there is principally, this is a 1990s recording. Again, I know this can come in special audio file pressings, it really isn't. This is a straight 16-bit 44 CD that I've ripped onto a hard drive, as all of these are. So again, we've hit the point where it's got louder and louder, and suddenly the music business caught on to this, and a lot of pop recordings became quite a bit louder because they punched through automatically. They'd sound better when people are playing them in record stores, they'd sound better when people are playing them on the radio, even though they're going to compress them more, they just sounded louder. The difficulty is that in many cases, that loud sound limits the number of times you want to listen to it, because you hear it and think that's great, but afterwards you think it's not so good. Now, in the early 2000s, in the latest years of the 20th century, people started to move from listening to music on, listening to music through stereo systems to listening through earphones, iPods, everything else. A lot of people started listening there, and especially in-ear monitors. Now, in-ear monitors are absolutely sensational. If you've been to Can Jam, they sound superb. But the same thing applies. People started to then say, well, let's push this still further and still further. Now, there's a limit to the amount of you can compress a piece of music the CD limit of 0 dB, 0 dB full scale. At that point, anything beyond that is in clipping. So if you're compressing and compressing the music up, there comes to a point where even if you're compressing it, it's still going to start to clip. So what we've got to now is we're jumping forward to maybe, I think about 2004, and I'm going to play a British band by the name of Muse. And I want you to just to listen to the levels of this and see if you think it's got a little louder. Great piece of music. Matt Bellamy, who plays for Muse, is a sensational guitarist and a complete weirdo. Really is. But what do we think of that? Louder? Mm-hmm. Quite a lot louder. Actually, that's almost all clipping. Now, what I'd hoped to do, and unfortunately we haven't had, is to do some charts on this. You're welcome to see them afterwards. I've loaded things into it. There's a free software program called Audacity, which allows you to load pieces of music in. Okay, you have to put them into WAV or MP3. I used lossless here, so it wouldn't speak, but I loaded them in as MP3 files, and you will see that you've got a tiny little, when you look at, say, Blueberry Hill, you've got this tiny little waveform and an awful lot of space between it. When you look at that one, you've got one big bar, one big blue bar of noise. We got to a point in the mid-aughties, where the most successful record, the best-selling record of the last decade was I Got a Feeling by the Black Eyed Peas. Now, I believe it has a dynamic range of about 3 decibels. At that point, and it's very, very loud. It sounds great, but it's very, very loud. The downside of that is it sounds great for about 3 plays, and you can't listen to it beyond that. Now, at the moment, what we've been talking about is lots of rock music. So obviously it doesn't apply to other genres. However, not so convinced. I'm going to play a piece of music from the early 70s, which is in a completely different frame. So, Carole King from, I think, about 1970, 71. Now that is, I believe, a kind of special remastered version, so it's actually kind of a little hot. It's a little loud anyway. But what I'm going to do now is play another singer-songwriter, one singer-songwriter from a few years ago, and see if you can hear the difference in volume level again.
Kids out of their coat, the way the babies have them and more. Oh, 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 oh. Unpacking the bags and sitting up, planted lilacs and buttercups. Oh, oh, oh.
again. Was that a little louder?
Yes.
Now we can do the same with jazz. Let's do the same with jazz very, very quickly. I'm going to play you some avant-garde British jazz. I've seen this band live. They are phenomenal. But this is how they record out. And so it goes on. Okay, they're an avant-garde jazz band. They play quite wild. But the recording is just cut hot. Very, very, very loud recording, very limited dynamic range, and just shouts. It sounds great on an iPod, great through little iPod headphones, lousy through good in-ear monitors, a little more lousy on good systems. That said, a good system can usually bring out the best of these things. And there is, fortunately, a little bit of movement now. Finally, we've started to see people backing down from the worst of this. I was talking outside to Michael Fremmer about this, and one of the great things in this, and one of the reasons why vinyl seems to be coming back, we think, I mean, there's a lot of reasons, psychological reasons, the fact it sounds great, all sorts of things, but one of the reasons that vinyl is suddenly becoming popular again with a new generation of people is that that loudness war, this thing of playing things louder and louder and louder, you can't do it on a record. Because if you do it on a record, you can play it once and the tracks collapse. And as such, they've pulled back from the brink. So a lot of people say, when you get kind of 20-year-olds saying, well, vinyl sounds better than CD, or vinyl sounds better than iTunes, or vinyl sounds better than my iPod. And part of the reason that they're saying that, actually, it wouldn't be an iPod, it'd probably be a BlackBerry, because that's what teenagers listen to. Anyway, part of the reason that they would say that is because it has to be pulled back from that loudness brink because the vinyl collapses. Now finally, the studios are starting to listen to this and they're starting to say, we're backing away from it. It's a very difficult avenue for studio executives to do because musicians want to be, if anyone's ever been in the studio, the bass player wants to be louder than the drummer wants to be louder than the guitarist wants to be louder than the bass player, and the singer wants to be louder than all of them. So you end up with this scenario where everyone's louder than everyone else. You also end up with an idea that an A&R man is always going to sit there and say that was a hit record and I'm not going to pull back from anything that made it that a hit record on my record, because if it's not a hit, I'm fired. So Black Eyed Peas was the most successful record. In the 80s, Oasis was a wonderfully successful Britpop band that made incredibly loud pieces of music. Incredibly loud, compressed pieces of music. And as a consequence, everyone had that vogue. We're finally starting to come out of the end of that now. But principally, what I'm trying to say here, at no point have I talked about high resolution. And high resolution is fine. I don't have a problem with high resolution at all. But I think in some respects, we're fighting the wrong war. Because we talk about high resolution audio, and it's a wonderful thing. It sounds great. And it sounds great to the 20 or 30 people, or the 200, 300 people who buy that high-resolution track. But what we need to do is we need to get to a grassroots level. I hate to say this, but I would rather... Well, actually, I don't even hate to say it. I would rather listen to a good recording played on iTunes in AAC, 192 kbps AAC, which is what you get if you download something from iTunes. I'd rather listen to that if it had a full dynamic range than listen to a wonderful 192, 24-bit 192 compressed recording, because that just doesn't get any better. That sounds awful. And if you've got a wonderful big recording of it, all you've got is a data hog. We need to move away from that. Roy, have you got your magic disc with you?
I do.
Fantastic. As a last piece, what we're going to do now is play. To say that, I would like to say how much we haven't got out of CD yet. CD, 16-bit, 44.1, polycarbonate disc, red book disc, is absolutely fine. Now, a couple of years back, those of you who read The Absolute Sound might have seen Robert Harley's editorial about the glass CD. Now, in his travels, Roy has managed to acquire one. Now, we're holding this very carefully. This is 18 layers of glass. It's still a Redbook CD. It's thicker. It's not thicker. It's slightly heavier.
About 2.5 times the weight.
Yeah, slightly heavier. But it's principally, it's everything, the same data files, the same pieces of music, the same, obviously the same piece of music, same recordings, same everything. It's a 16-bit 44.1 Redbook PCM CD, just happens to be made of glass, and cost an astonishing amount of money. What we're going to do for you, first of all, is...
we'll play you the polycarbonate version.
Play you the polycarbonate version.
Straight CD, as you would get off a shelf. One thing, anybody who attends classical concerts, just shut your eyes when you listen to this.
Expensive, and Roy will let you have a play with one of these, but if you break it, not only will you have hands covered in glass, but
that's
you're
the standard polycarbonate.
You're okay. Down by
just
about
like a normal diff.
Down by about 3,000
2,000
$2,000.
I have two really good vinyl recordings of this. Yeah, my first commentary was boom.
This is actually not a great orchestra. Oh, it's just a
shocking, isn't it?
It is shocking.
It's top of that crap.
Sorry.
No. When I first heard this, I didn't hear this disc. I heard a 63 Carian Beethoven 9th transferred to glass CD.
Wow.
And I heard it at the house of the editor of a Chinese magazine. And I sat there and I thought, I have never heard anything like this before. And my wife was there, and she'd been sort of relegated in the pecking order to the back row of seating in this guy's room. And come on. And I sat her in the middle of the sofa while I was playing, and she sat there with her eyes shut, and she listened for about 30 seconds, and she just looked at me and she said, it's just like being at the festival hall. And it's just got this uncanny sense of clarity and dynamic freedom. It just, it communicates in the same way as a live orchestra. And digitally, they're identical.
Is anyone pursuing this?
It's, unfortunately, I think the difficulty with it is
an incredibly difficult, complex, expensive process. I mean, there's 18 layers of micro-thin glass made there. So there's obviously there's a strong possibility that this will go horribly wrong. What we can play, just as a last part there, is that I've got a piece of music on CD and on XRCD. Now, XRCDs are available. They're not freely available, but we know you can get them. If you like, we can do the same thing again.
Just to answer the question, the specific question, is anyone actively pursuing this? Yes. There are specialist labels in Japan. The Carrie-Anne, there were 250 copies. They're all gone. I tried to bring that. Lincoln wouldn't lend it to me, oddly enough, even though he's got two. He lent me this one very kindly. There are a couple of audiophile labels who are actively looking at this. They will never, ever be cheap, but they will get a lot cheaper than $2,000.
Yeah. I mean, principally, this is the special collection. You're never going to find every mainstream piece of music there. I mean, in the same way as with something like XRCD, it's going to be very limited range of products. I mean, with XRCD, it's slightly different because we're looking at two different mixes. One's a Rudy Van Gelder mix, one's a kind of pristine Japanese mix. So we're looking at two slightly different things. So they would sound different anyway. Whereas with this, what we've had is precisely the same mastering. Just one has been mastered to polycarded, one has been mastered with glass. We think it's so astounding that it's worth listening. But I will play as a closer, a little bit of Freddie Hubbard. It does take a little while to read.
Well, if the glass makes that much difference, that would say that the reading of the CD makes a huge difference.
XRCD.
XRCD 24.
XRCD 24, yeah, thank you. Come on. So again, there's still room for growth. I mean, okay, so that's pushing the Red Book standard a little bit, quite a little bit. But how did you find that?
Much different than spatial presentation.
Yeah.
More detail.
just a nicer piece of, sounds like a nicer piece of music. You want to listen to it more. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that's about it. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. If there's anything you want to say now. No, I didn't buy you all for this. Yes.
I engaged you last evening and put on Carole King. If you ever, and this has actually happened to me, DJing at least once, if you ever want to make a middle-aged woman cry, put that album on, particularly the 180 gram 30th anniversary reissue of it.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, they'll come up. I had one come up in tears. She said, I couldn't believe you played this. She said, I must see the album. You know, it was amazing.
When I played a series of DJ gigs at the Royal Festival Hall in London, and one of the things he ended up playing was a complete, from beginning to end, playing Ziggy Stardust. And I had the advantage of being, all we did, we played it on a nice record to play. It was playing the best of British to the best, on the best of British. We had a very good UK hi-fi system of a Riga turntable, name amplifiers, DCS, and B&W loudspeakers, and a few other bits and pieces. And we played this system to lots and lots of people, about 70, 80 people at a time, in a room that was hotter than this. And we asked them to play the complete album from beginning. We played the complete album from beginning to end, and all that we said was, please just respect the record, listen to it as a piece of, don't walk out, don't text, don't take your phone out, turn your phone off, because you know we spend so much time Facebooking that we're listening to a piece of music that we forget that we're actually not listening to the piece of music. So it was just saying, respect the recording. And in the process, when he watched this Ziggy Stardust, and as I said, I had the advantage of being sitting at the side watching the audience, and we had a complete air band. Now, I've seen people play air guitar, we had air sax, air backing vocal, air bass guitar, air violin. That was really impressive. I didn't even know there was a violin section in it, but they were playing. Everyone was playing. And it was a fascinating, it was a group experience, and people at the end were crying, they were saying all sorts of things. We also played a Joy Division record, and by the end of that, there were people ready to commit suicide. And I was but it's a fascinating experience. I urge anyone to try. There's a movement in the UK started up by a DJ by the name of Colleen Cosmo Murphy called Classic Album Sundays, and it's just started to hit the US. Mikey Friend was talking about it. It started in Manhattan, and it's starting to, Brooklyn, it's starting to grow. And it's just basically people turning up, pitching up at the top floor of a bar, a pub, with a good audio system and a person who knows their music, and they will sit and play a complete record to a small audience who will maybe put a donation in, possibly to charity, possibly just a donation to fund the thing. And people are now starting to play this and listening to whole pieces of music. Obviously, it depends on the record, because some records have a beginning, middle, and an end, and those are beautiful. And the ones that are just the best of, greatest hits, don't necessarily work in this way. But when you hear them, they sound incredible. As a group, collective thing, when you all sit and listen to one whole album, at the end of it, you cry, you dance, you move, you have all sorts of fantastic experiences. And it's some kind of atavistic thing that we're so... it's a part where... I love the whole can jam thing. The headphone thing is sensational. But there are times when you want to take that off and have a communal experience. And this communal audiophile experience of Classic Album Sundays is sensational. Anyway, any other questions?
So this may be a naive question because you didn't really quite address it, but what's actually happening between the plastic and the glass? Why are we hearing that?
Roy, over to you on that one, because I have absolutely no idea.
Oh, okay.
In terms of the mechanism, why does it sound so different? I can't really give you chapter and verse. I mean, obviously there are optical differences and there are differences in optical clarity. But there are also, and I suspect this is much more important, physical differences. And one of the things that we are rapidly discovering or rediscovering is that actually, as Alan said, numbers are just numbers. And when you're talking about hi-fi, it nearly always comes down to the physical. It's always down to the mechanical interface. It's always down to the how you spin the disc, how much the disc weighs, how it vibrates, all of those things. And I suspect that actually it's much more about the physical and the optical than anything else. But that's guesswork.
So were you to rip both that?
We don't know.
Yeah,
everyone asks this.
Yeah.
If you rip it, will it sound better? And yes, I think it will. I don't think it'll sound like that, but I think it'll sound better than a standard CD.
One of the interesting discussions that I've had with a UK company called by the name of name, they have a device called a Unity Serve, which is a special ripping device for streaming. And they swear that the sound of a rip made on the Unity Serve is better than the sound of a rip made on Mac with XLD. And they've done demonstrations and they've done tests on this. Now this is on the sort of physics side of things, on the sort of engineering side of things, that's impossible, bit to bit, technically. The more we listen to them, the more we think, well, yeah, but maybe they are, but something happens in process. Something happens that changes. Whatever it is, we don't know. Will it stand up to rigorous scrutiny? Again, we don't know, but certainly people who sit and listen to it say, I prefer one over the other. Anyway, any other questions? Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, thanks very much for coming. Hope it's been informative.
Thank you.